All right, next on our agenda, chapter 12, fluids. And so first we need to identify what a fluid is. Well, you might think that a fluid is a liquid and that that's the only thing it can be, but no, turns out a fluid can be a liquid or a gas. Because, for example, our jet stream, which carries storm systems around the Earth, is basically a river of air moving along. And so gases can also have fluid-like properties and obey similar equations to our fluid equations for a liquid. Okay? But what is not a fluid is a solid. Okay, so our states of matter then first, solid is basically molecules that are locked into place. Such that if you are a molecule and you look up, or you look to your left, or you look to your right, you always see the same molecule to your left or to your right, even if the whole system is rotated. Relative to you within that molecule, this molecule will always be behind you, this one will always be to your right, the one over here would be to your left, this one would be above you, that one would be below you. And so you'd always have the same buddies nearby and the same relative configurations. And so those molecules are locked into place. Now, we can model the connections, the molecular connections that provide bonds as being spring-like forces. Even though it's not really springs that are holding these molecules together, these are electrostatic forces, which are attractions between positive and negative charges, between the positives that are in the nucleus of an atom and the negative electrons that are circling around. That gives rise to molecular bonds. Now, if you increase the temperature, though, you can shake these atoms apart. So if you shake them apart, you can get a liquid. So you break the solid bonds, and you could do this by adding some kind of energy, like temperature. To do this. And then the molecules will tend to still be fairly close to each other, but the molecules will flow past each other and will not have the same relative configuration. So generally they're still close together, just like in a solid, but they don't maintain this locked into place configuration. They can flow past each other. Okay, and so water is a perfect example of this. Water, in actuality, has a separation distance between the molecules where it's closer together when it's in the liquid state than when it's in the solid state. If we look at water, that's a hexagonal crystal. And a hexagonal crystal has a lot of space in these gaps. As we can build this thing up from a whole sequence of hexagons, which happen to fit together pretty nicely. But we can see all this empty space that's between them. When you melt some water, then the average distance of the molecules actually shrinks by maybe 10%. And so this is unusual. Normally, a solid has a greater density and a smaller distance between the atoms than it does in the liquid state. But it's lucky for us that this is the case for water, because if it weren't, then when something froze, say in the water, if the water froze, it would freeze from the bottom up, and ice would not tend to float, because ice is less dense than water, and so we'll see that this has a tendency to make it want to float. But by it floating, it creates an insulating layer which protects the environment beneath the ice cap. And so that allows then for creatures that are living in that kind of an environment to have like an igloo effect, which insulates them and keeps them warmer and allows for survival. And so we probably wouldn't have survived in some of the very cold conditions which existed, say, 550 million years ago when there was the snowball Earth. If, in fact, the ocean bottom had froze from the bottom up instead of the top down. And so this can be a good thing then, that molecules in some cases can be closer together in the liquid state, but they can still flow past each other. Then in a gas, the molecules are still have fluid-like properties, but the molecules now are far apart. So we completely break the bonds. I'll say here, almost broken. Because there can still be some forces between gas molecules, although they're relatively small forces, but they can still exist in a gaseous state. But for the most part, we can think of the bonds as being completely broken in such a manner that the molecules are now far apart from each other. And by far here, this is a relative term, but we're referring to many molecular diameters apart, okay, rather than being so close that they're all crowded together so that the distance between them is comparable to the size of the atom. Okay. And so, as we said, gases can have fluid-like properties but behave a little different from liquids. They can be compressed more easily, because the molecules are already pretty far apart, whereas in a liquid, they're close together, so it's hard to squeeze them even tighter together when they're already close together. But with a gas, you can squeeze down on it, changing it, what we call its pressure, more easily than you can when it's in a liquid state. And then finally, we have a plasma, which is actually the state of matter that most of the universe is in, although it's the one that we're least familiar with, because it's an ionized gas. And so we have hydrogen atoms ionized in the intergalactic medium, and 99.5% of all of the matter in the universe is in hydrogen gas clouds. And only 0.5% is in the normal states of matter that we see in stars and planets. But so this can be hydrogen gas in the intergalactic medium. But it can also be the hot ionized gas inside the sun. So that would be the kind of plasma that we often refer to in terms of what's going on in the inside of stars. Okay, and so each one of these then is indicative of a state of matter in which we are slowly but surely increasing the energy of the molecules in order to achieve a different state of matter. And so with these ideas in mind, then, we can look a little more specifically at fluids. And there are certain properties that we haven't talked about much so far that we should talk about now that deal with things like pressure. And we can define the average pressure on an object as being the total force divided by the area over which the force acts. So this is a measure then. Pressure is a measure of the concentration of force on an area. So this is average pressure, because we're talking about total force here. So this is the sum of all forces on the area divided by the area. And so that should have units of Newton per square meter, because the units for area are square meter, the units for force are newtons. Okay, but before I get to those kind of units, let's just look at a couple of more common types of units that we may have experienced in the past that deal with PSI, or pounds per square inch. So in other words, when you're measuring tire pressure, a lot of times in America at least, this would be measured in pounds per square inch. Whereas newtons per square meter is what's called a pascal. And is the preferred metric unit. But just so that we can get a feeling for this, let's say that I take my thumb and I push my thumb down on a surface. Okay? So I push down like this on the surface, and let's say that I'm putting 20 pounds of force on the area of my thumb. Okay, so here's the area of my thumb, and I apply this force, let's say 20 pounds, and let's say the area of my thumb is 2 square inches. I don't know if that's right or not, but let's just say that it is. Then the pressure would be equal to 20 pounds divided by 2 square inches, which would be the same thing as 10 pounds per square inch. So that the meaning of this is that each square inch of area is getting 10 pounds of force. Okay, so if we're talking in terms of Newton per square meter, then we'd be saying a certain number of Newtons of force are being applied to every square meter. And so that would be another equivalent definition. But now, instead of this being a pressure that's exerted on my thumb, let's say that instead we want to apply the force on a small portion of my thumb. Let's just say a little tip of the pen area. Okay, and so I push down. Let's say that now I apply this 20 pounds worth of force onto just the tip of this pen, and I start feeling pain. And so my body's telling me, stop doing this, you idiot. You are going to impale your thumb. And so, but it, let's say that I have a thimble on or something that would protect my thumb from damage. And let's apply the same force now, but over a smaller area. So I'm not changing the force. We'll keep the force at 20 pounds. But now we'll make the area 1/100th of a square inch. Okay, so we can see then that the force hasn't changed, but the concentration of force has. Because now the new pressure is going to be much larger. It's going to be 20 pounds divided by 1/100 inches squared, or that would be 20 multiplied by 100. Okay, and so that would be 2,000 pounds per square inch. Okay, and so this would then be a concentration of force on an area that would overwhelm the ability of my normal skin on my thumb to withstand that force. And so I would need to have some kind of protection. So we can see then that pressure is not the same thing as just force, and it's not the same thing as area, but it's a measure of the concentration of force on an area. And so this is an important concept. We might wonder, well, why haven't we talked about it before, if it's this important? And the answer is because we have had well-defined masses for our previous discussions. And so now our masses are kind of statistical because you've got many, many atoms in a fluid that are moving around. It's going to be very difficult to track one of them. But you can look at the statistical properties of many masses, and you can say that there is an average effect of these many masses. And that gives rise to a total force divided by an area. But you could be dealing with, say, 10 to the 24th power of molecules in a certain amount of fluid. And these molecules are very small. You know, typically, the size of an atom, you made a comparison between an orange and the size of the Earth, that's the same as the ratio of the size of an atom to an orange. Okay, so atoms are very, very small. And so if we're dealing then statistically with large number of atoms, even in a small amount of fluid, it means that we're looking at a statistical kind of a consideration. Okay, so let's go ahead then and let's talk about pressure at the surface of the Earth due to the atmosphere. So the atmosphere has weight. And so therefore, there should be a force of the weight of the atmosphere pushing on the areas of our bodies or on any other object that's on the surface of the Earth. And so how could we measure this? Well, we could measure a column, the weight of a column of the atmosphere, that is, say, the height of the atmosphere, let's say 250 miles high, just to make sure we've got most of the atmosphere in there, but 1 inch by 1 inch for our base side. So this is a 1 square inch column of the atmosphere. We're going to weigh that. So on this side of the scale, we want to put something else to weigh it, but we're going to have to protect this side from atmospheric pressure. Because if this side is also feeling atmospheric pressure, then it won't work. Okay, so we have to be careful how we set this up. But if we are measuring just this column of the atmosphere that's 250 miles high, what we'd have to do on this side is put a weight that's equal to 14.7 pounds. So that's how much each square inch of the atmosphere weighs. And so because of that, we say that one atmosphere's pressure is equal to 14.7 pounds per square inch. Or, if we want to write this in our more conventional Pascal units, we could write this as 1.01 times 10 to the fifth power Pascals. So it's about 100,000 Pascals. But remember that Pascal is our abbreviation for Newton per square meter. Okay, and so this is a much bigger number because a square meter is way bigger than a square inch. And so that means that you could fit a lot more square inches into a square meter. And also Newton, I think, is something like 4.5 Newtons equals 1 pound. So that also gives you a little bit of a scaling up of this number. Okay, so that means then that I must be pretty strong if I can hold up the weight of all of these columns of air with my arms, right? Because if each one is weighing 14.7 pounds, I must be lifting thousands of pounds. Amazing. Well, no, not so amazing, because anybody can do that, and that's not the kind of pressure that we feel. It's not that we're lifting up the weight of the atmosphere, but rather the forces that are associated with the atmosphere. This is an important rule that we should be clear about. Forces that are associated with the pressure always act perpendicular to the surface. So in other words, here, let's say we're talking about the force of the atmosphere on my head. Then it's not giving me a flat top, but rather it's an imploding pressure in which all of the forces are acting perpendicular to the surface of my head. And so pressure itself, we should mention here, very important, pressure is a scalar, not a vector. So we would never, ever want to talk about pressure vectors. And this is something that we have to be careful about, because the forces are vectors that are associated with the pressure. But pressure itself is a scalar. If you measure your tire pressure in your car, it doesn't matter which way you orient the pressure gauge, it's still going to be the same pressure. And so it's a scalar quantity. But the forces are vectors, and the forces have to act perpendicular to the surface. So I'll try to justify why that's true in a moment. But if we use that here, then let's find the net force on my head due to the atmosphere. And so say, well, how many square inches is your head? And is your head a sphere? The answer is no. But let's assume that it is. And let's say that the area is equal to 100 square inches, which is just an easy number for me to work with. Okay. So if that's the case, then force over area equals pressure. And here I'm using units of pounds per square inch again. So our force then would be pressure times area, 14.7 pounds per square inch times 100 square inches is going to be equal to 1,470 pounds. Okay, oh my gosh, that's enough to give you a pretty big headache. Okay, but that is about right. That's how big those forces are that are pushing in and crushing you, basically, smashing your head. And so the only thing that's preventing your head from imploding is that your skull has a certain strength, that can push back on this pressure. And also you have fluid pressures inside of your body that can compensate for these outside forces. And so this is what prevents the surface of your skull from imploding inward. But if you go to higher elevation and suddenly the force on the outside is lower than the force on the inside, then what will happen is that you start getting ruptured blood vessels, you can get altitude sickness, you see that your eyes start getting very bloodshot, you can get headaches, and so this is all associated with altitude sickness. And even just a slight change in elevation can cause problems with you adjusting to the difference in pressure, because you get used to a certain balance between the inward forces and the outward forces, say at sea level, and then you move to Denver, Colorado, and the pressures are much lower up there, then it may take your body a while to adjust to these variations. Okay, so next, what I wanted to do is talk a little bit about density. Here's another statistical quantity. Now, oftentimes we'll call density rho, and that is a concentration of mass in a certain volume. And so typically then, we'll be using for pressure, units of pascals, which is a newton per meter squared. But for density, we'll use units of kilograms per meter cubed, and not grams per cubic centimeter, as you might have seen, for example, in a chemistry class. Now, there are situations where we will use a density of grams per cubic centimeter, but not usually. Okay, and so this is another way then to identify the statistical properties of matter without having to look exactly at what each mass is doing. We can say, well, I'll just add up all of the masses in a certain volume and that'll give me the density. Or I'll just add up all of the forces of all these molecules on a given area and that'll be my pressure. Okay, and so with these two quantities in mind, what I'd like to do next is to calculate the variation in pressure with depth beneath a fluid surface. And a typical fluid surface might, for example, be the surface of the ocean. But it doesn't have to be. And so this could be the air above the ocean, and this could be the water in the ocean. And so we know what the atmospheric pressure is at the surface, but let's now go down to a certain depth, we'll call here y. So y then is our depth beneath the surface. And then let's figure out what the force is of this weight of water on this area. So that then would give us the increased pressure at a depth y beneath the surface. Now, this doesn't have to, again, be ocean water. This could be a bunch of liquid mercury. And we could be finding the pressure at depth beneath the surface of a column of mercury, as you might do for, say, a thermometer or something like that. Or barometer. But in this case, let's think in terms of mass as equaling density times volume. it's mass over volume is density, and so this then is volume, and this is the total mass in that volume. So how much mass then do we have in this volume? Well, it's going to be equal to the density of water. Now what is the density of water? Okay, well I know that it's 1 gram per cubic centimeter. Some of you might say that. And that would be correct. 1 gram of water occupies a cubic centimeter's worth of volume. But that's not the right units for most of the problems that we'll be doing in this class. And so what we need to look at then is a conversion of these units. So we have 1 kilogram for every 10 to the 3 grams. And we have to convert here. So this is going to be 100 centimeters cubed for every cubic meter. Okay, so remember, and this was a subject that we looked at a little more in chapter 1, when you are converting to cubic units, you also have to cube the conversion factor. So this is 10 to the 6 divided by 10 to the 3, or 10 to the 3 kilograms per cubic meter. So it's 1 gram per cc, but it's 1,000 kilograms per cubic meter, the density of water. Okay, and so now we can write that mass is density times volume. So what's the volume here? Well, if we call this L and L and Y, then for this cubic rectangular solid, we have the density, 10 to the 3 kilograms per meter cubed. We'll keep it as density for the moment, just for a general expression. Times the volume. So that's going to be L squared times Y. Okay, and so then the total weight is going to be mg. So we'll multiply this by g. That's the total weight in that column. And that column is L by L by Y in terms of its dimensionality. Okay, so the pressure then at depth is the total weight divided by the area. So what's the area? Well, the area is just L times L, or L squared. So this is rho L squared YG divided by L squared. And we get the somewhat astonishing result that the pressure at depth is equal to something that doesn't involve the size of the column, but only involves the depth of the column. Okay, so this is only a function of the depth of the fluid column and not a function of the area of the column, because the area terms cancel out of this expression. So that may not seem so surprising until we look at a couple of examples up on the data projector in which we have the same pressure at depth in all three of these cases. They're connected fluid, so the pressure here is rho gy, the pressure here is rho gy, the pressure here is rho gy, even though it looks like there's a lot more water funneling its force and focusing its force onto this area. Those effects cancel because some of that force is acting perpendicular to the surface and only the vertical component is acting down. And so this is actually the reason why in all three of these cases, even for a very irregularly shaped fluid column, the pressure of all three of those fluids is the same at the depth, at that depth. And so if we want the total pressure then at depth, We can say that P total is equal to the pressure at the surface, which is P atmosphere, plus rho gy. And y is, again, the depth of our, that we're at beneath that fluid surface. Okay? And so our atmospheric pressure in metric units is approximately 10 to the 5 pascals. Now remember before I said it was 1.01 times 10 to the 5, but that's just a 1% error. And so if we throw that out, we have an easy number here that we can use for atmospheric pressure. And so let's ask then, well, what's the total pressure if we're 10 meters down? Then P total is going to be 10 to the 5 pascals plus rho, that's 10 to the 3 kilograms per cubic meter. Times g, 10 meters per second squared, times y, which is 10 meters, or about 33 feet. So we see then this gives us another factor of 10 to the 5, so that we have 2 times 10 to the 5 pascals, or that's 2 atmospheres pressure. Now, because water is somewhat incompressible, as we go down even deeper, we can maintain the same value for the density. Now, that's not the case with air. Air compresses as a function of how much pressure is acting, quite a bit. But water, not so much. It does compress a little. If you were to go all the way to the deepest part of our ocean, Marianas Trench, you would be down at maybe 7 miles deep, and at that depth, the density might increase by 5 to 10%. Okay, so, but near the surface, we can keep this 10 to the 3 constant, and so we can say then that for every 10 meters depth beneath the surface of the oceans, we increase by 1 atmosphere. So on the planet Venus, we have a pressure that's something like 100 times our atmospheric pressure here on the Earth. And so if we work that out in terms of increasing the pressure here by 1 atmosphere for every 10 meters depth, 100 times 10, okay, so that brings us to 1,000 meters beneath the surface of the ocean. So if we wanted to mimic the effects of atmospheric pressure on Venus, we would have to go 3,000 feet, roughly, a little more than 3,000 feet, or 1,000 meters beneath the surface of our oceans. And at that depth, you could work out the amount of pressure that you would feel, but it would basically be like the weight of a car pushing in on you, kind of smashing you from all directions. And so you would need some kind of a protective suit to keep that pressure from killing you.